Hello and good morning to everyone everywhere. Welcome to the 11 a.m. Sunday Assembly at the Orange Vale Church of Christ. My name is Chuck Polis, and in addition to our online assembly that's happening right now, we also have an in-person indoor assembly that happens at 9 a.m. on Sunday mornings. And so if you're in the neighborhood next Sunday morning at 9, we pray that you'll join us. Later on today at 6, we have a Zoom adult Bible class that's looking at the Gospel of John, and tonight we'll be in John chapter 8. And then on Wednesday nights, our Zoom Bible class at 7 is studying the book of Genesis. Plus, we have a Zoom children's class that happens at 5:30 p.m. on Tuesdays, and that class is for children between the ages of 8 and 12 years old. And we also have a comprehensive, work-at-your-own-pace kind of Bible study with a real-life Bible study helper, and you can sign up for that by visiting our website at ovchurch.org and clicking on the banner for World Bible School. And if you want more information on any of those classes, even some tech support on how to get connected with Zoom, please message us through Facebook or YouTube, or you can email me directly at minister@ovchurch.org, and we'll get you the Zoom ID and the class materials that you need and get you connected. We also want to make sure that you're aware that after every 9 a.m. assembly here at our building, we have a lemonade social with drinks and snacks. And of course, everyone's invited to join us. Plus tonight, September 12th at 5 p.m., everyone's invited to our Sunday night supper and study up at the Lincoln Church of Christ. And this is a potluck, so please bring something to share. And then at 6, we'll have our regular Bible study in the Gospel of John. And for those who are connecting with Zoom for the Bible study, don't worry, you'll still be able to connect if you're not there in person. And like last week, there are still a number of wildfires going on around us. We want to continue to pray for their containment and for the firefighters and for everyone affected by the fires and the smoke. Plus, today is the day after the 20th anniversary of the attacks that happened on September 11th of 2001, so we want to remember that event. As always, if you have any announcements for next week's bulletin or prayer requests, please let us know. Let's pray. Most Holy Father, dear God, we do so want to thank you for giving us another Lord's Day that we can come and worship you, sing songs of praise, and study your word, and meet around the table. And Father, we're mindful of all those affected by the fires here and the smoke, and we pray that you will give us some relief. And Father, we're mindful that after 20 years, so many lives have still been impacted by the disastrous events on September 11th, 2001. And Father, we pray for those families that were immediately impacted by the loss of loved ones. And Father, we just ask that you'll be with all those families and the people around the world that are reflecting upon that tragic event 20 years ago. Father, we pray for your blessings and your mercy in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. Today's scripture reading is from the book of James. I'll be reading James 1, 22 through 25 from the International Version. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves, but what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like a man who looks at his face in a mirror and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But the man who looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues to do this, not forgetting what he has heard, but doing it, he will be blessed in what he does.
Father in heaven, how we love you. We lift your name in all the earth. May your kingdom be established in our praises. As your people declare your mighty works, blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty. love you. We lift your name in all the earth. May your kingdom be established in our praises. As your people declare your mighty works, blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is to come. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who reigns forevermore. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Blessed be the Lord God Almighty, who reigns forevermore.
Jesus, you were all to me. Why did you die on Calvary? O Lamb of God, I fail to see how this could be part of the plan. They say that you're alive again, but I saw death and every sin reach out to claim their darkest wish. How could this be part of the plan? If I could only hold your hand and touch the scars where nails were driven, I would need to feel your side where holy flesh by spear was riven. Holy face, a vision filling time and space. Your nearness makes my spirit race. Could this be part of the plan? I see the wounds that cause the cry from heaven, ocean, earth, and sky. When people watch their Savior die, could this be part of the plan? Reaching out to hold your hand and touch the scars where nails were driven, coming near, I feel your side where holy flesh by spear was riven. Part of a heavenly plan.
I proudly say with blazon cry, you are my Lord and my God.
It's at this time that we would like to invite you to share the Lord's Supper with us, wherever you may be. You know, over the years I have found it fascinating that there aren't very many examples of New Covenant worship assemblies recorded for us in the New Testament. But of the few examples that we find, we see Christians gathering on the first day of the week to share the Lord's Supper, to hear preaching, even to share in a fellowship meal afterwards. Take a look over at Acts chapter 20, and let's read verses 7 through 11. There we're told that on the first day of the week, we, and that would be the Apostle Paul and Luke and other Christians traveling with them, came together to break bread. Paul spoke to the people, and because he intended to leave the next day, kept on talking to midnight. There were many lamps in the upstairs room where we were meeting. Seating in a window was a young man named Eutychus, who was sinking into a deep sleep as Paul talked on and on. When he was sound asleep, he fell to the ground from the third story and was picked up dead. Paul went down, threw himself on the young man, and put his arms around him. "Don't be alarmed," he said. "He's alive." Then he went upstairs and broke bread and ate. After talking until daylight, he left. Now, there is definitely a lot going on in this text, but what I want us to focus on is that Christians regularly made it a point to assemble on the first day of the week to break bread. In other words, to share in the Lord's Supper, remembering the body and blood of Jesus. And so now, almost a couple of thousand years after Jesus' command to remember him in the bread and the cup, we gather together in our buildings or our homes or wherever we might be and share the Lord's Supper together, even though we might be apart. Let's pray. Father God, we want to thank you so much for this bread that represents your Son's body. And Father, as we give thanksgiving for it, help us to remember all that Jesus has done for us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Shall we continue in prayer? Most Holy Father, dear God, as we partake of this cup, help us to remember the blood that was shed on the cross, the blood that gives us forgiveness of sins and the hope of resurrection and eternity with you. Father, we thank you. In Christ's name we pray. That concludes the Lord's Supper. And it's at this time, out of a matter of convenience, that we take up the offering. And again, I want to thank all of those who have either brought by or mailed in their support for the church here in Orangevale. May God continue to bless you as you have blessed others. Let me go ahead and share with you from 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 6 and 7, where we're told to remember this: whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each man should give what he has decided in his heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And so, if you're able, we ask that if you can help support the ministry here at Orangevale and the missions that we help to support around the world, that you do so as a cheerful giver. Let's pray. Father God, dear God, we thank you for blessing us so much. And Father, as we reflect upon all that you've blessed us with, Father, might we return the blessing to further your kingdom. Father, we thank you for loving us and giving us your Son. And we pray that this offering to you might further your kingdom, to your glory, in Jesus' name. As always, you're welcome to bring your check by the next time you visit us here at the building, or you can use whatever services your bank offers, possibly bill pay, or of course, you could always mail a check and send it to 5915 Main Avenue, Orangevale, California, 95662. It's at this time that we want to encourage you to sing along with the song before the message today.
Today what tomorrow may bring, if shadow or sunshine or rain. The Lord I know ruleth o'er everything, and all of my worry is vain.
Living by faith,
yes, living by faith,
in Jesus above,
in Jesus above.
Trusting,
confiding in his great love, yes, in his great love. From all our safe in his sheltering arm,
I'm living by faith,
and feel no alarm,
feel no alarm.
Lord will return to this earth some sweet day. Our troubles will then all be o'er. The Master so gently will lead us away beyond that blessed heavenly shore.
Living by faith.
Yes, living by faith.
In Jesus above.
In Jesus above.
Trusting confide.
Trusting confiding in His great love. Yes, in His great love. From a heart safe in His sheltering arm, His sheltering arm.
I'm living by faith.
I'm living by faith and feel no alarm, feel no alarm.
Living by faith.
Yes, living by faith.
In Jesus above.
In Jesus above.
Trusting, confide.
Trusting, confiding in His great love. Yes, in His great love. Sheltering arm, His sheltering arm.
I'm living by faith.
I'm living by faith and feel no alarm, feel no alarm.
Hello again. Let me ask you, have you ever caught your kids knowing better but doing the exact opposite? And you know what I mean, they're doing something rather crazy and they hurt themselves. He's saying, yeah, you know better. And of course they do know better. Well, what about you? Have you ever done something, I don't know, stupid, and then you say to yourself, you know, I shouldn't have done that, I know better. Well, James writes over in James chapter 1 and verse 22, reminding us to not merely listen to the word and so deceive ourselves, do what it says. In other words, you know, if you know what to do, then why don't you do it, you know? Now, we're going to go ahead and dedicate a whole message to that subject in a few weeks. But today, we just want to talk about the book of James in general, kind of basically an introduction to our sermon series, A Faith That Works, a look at the book of James. Now, with the exception of the book of Proverbs, there's probably no more practical book in the whole Bible other than the book of James. And that was true back in the first century, and it's been true ever since. I mean, think about it. Do people still have trials and temptations to deal with? Sure they do. And are things like prejudice and discrimination still a problem today? Sure it is. And do some people only want to, I don't know, talk about their faith without actually living it? Yeah, well, yeah, they sure do. And are the people of God ever tempted by worldliness? Well, you know, that's always been a problem. And so really, as long as there are people alive, well, problems like those are going to exist. And that's why the book of James will always be necessary, because it covers all of these obstacles to growing spiritually and growing to be more like God and Christ. And so we need James. Now, the title of our sermon series and our sermon today is kind of punny. What I mean by that is, you know, it's a play on words, right? Think about it. We need a faith that works. Because, you know, we don't want a faith that doesn't work, right? We don't want one that's ineffective in our own life. And of course, James wants us to know that the only kind of faith that works is a faith, well, that works. In other words, a faith that is active. We all need to have an active faith. Or more to the point, a faith that's obedient to God's word and puts God's word into practice in our lives. That's how faith and works go together. And that's important because ultimately our faith needs to make a difference in the way that we live every day. Okay, so for today, let's just ask two basic questions and do our best to answer them. And those two questions are, who wrote this letter, and who is it written to? And keeping with our works pun, if you will, we'll answer the question, who is the author of this letter, with the answer to the question, the James that works. So which James works? Which James works? Well, of course, the final author of every word in the Bible is the Holy Spirit, right? And while that's true, of course, the Holy Spirit used a select few people to reveal God's truths to, so they can get it down to you and me. Now, we know from James chapter 1 and verse 1 that the writer is James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. But again, which James is that? Well, we can look at all the James, but still we have to figure out which James works, right? Well, the first thing that we have to realize is that the original recipients of the letter had to have known which James it was that was writing them, okay? And that means that this James must have been a familiar figure in the early church. Still, which James are we talking about here? What I mean is, you know, there's James the son of Zebedee, who is the brother of John the son of Zebedee, right? And then there's James the son of Alphaeus, and James the brother of Jesus. And there's also James the younger and James the father of Judas, not Iscariot. Now, out of everyone among those Jameses, only James, the son of Zebedee, who is the brother of John, the son of Zebedee, and James, the brother of Jesus, could really be described as well-known figures in the New Testament. After all, chances are you didn't even know the other James I mentioned, right? Anyway, so out of those two, a lot of people tend to focus on James, the son of Zebedee, who again is the brother of John, right? And that's because John is the apostle of love. He has a gospel, you know. So a lot of people think, well, that's got to be the other James, right? His brother. So most people think about that James because that James was a part of Jesus' inner circle, right? And that included Peter, James, and John. And those three are the three that often went with Jesus when they went off on little, I don't know, sometimes I call them field trips. Like when Jesus went up on the Mount of Transfiguration, he had Peter, James, and John with him. And also at other times they went off together. Now, we are almost 100% sure that that James did not write this letter. And that's because he died as a martyr in 44 AD. And the book of James was almost certainly written later than that. Take a look at Acts chapter 12 and verses 1 and 2. There we're told that it was about this time that King Herod arrested some who belonged to the church, intending to persecute them. He had James, the brother of John, put to death with the sword. So with James, the son of Zebedee, not an option for us, for this being the James that works, that only really leaves us with James, the brother of Jesus, as the James that works. Okay, so who is this James, the brother of Jesus, and what makes him qualified to write such an incredible letter that stood the test of time? Well, in a couple of places, we're told that Jesus had four brothers. There was James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon. Of course, Jesus' father is God, and Jesus' brother's father was Joseph. Still, they had the same mother, Mary, and so they are brothers. Well, you know, some would say stepbrothers or half-brothers, but either way, they're still brothers, okay? Now, Hebrew tradition lists the names of son in age order, oldest to youngest. And so since James is listed first, he was most likely the oldest of the four and closest in age to Jesus. Now, the fact that Jesus' brother, James, is the writer means that there was an amazing transformation of faith that happened in James' life. How do we know that? Well, over in John chapter 7 and verse 5, we're told that even his own brothers, even Jesus' own brothers, and that includes James, did not believe in him. And then over in Mark chapter 3 and verses 20 and 21, It even appears that James was among those who wanted to put an end to Jesus' public ministry. Here's what the text tells us. Jesus entered a house, and again, a crowd gathered, so that he and his disciples were not even able to eat. When his family, which would include James, remember, he's the eldest son, he's going to be there, okay, heard about this, they went to take charge of him, for they said, he's out of his mind. In other words, they didn't believe that he said who he said he was, and we're going to go ahead and take him home because he's gone a little cuckoo. They think, wow, you know, that James was of the opinion that Jesus was an older brother that kind of lost it, you know. But all that changed. You have to think, well, what happened that was so incredible that changed James? Well, the most obvious thing that happened was the horrible execution of his older brother, Jesus. But that wasn't all, right? Because all the crucifixion did was really confirm Jesus' humanity and his death. The thing that happened that changed everything, including James's mind, was the resurrection. And that's because the resurrection confirms Jesus' messiahship and his divinity. And we know that this had an incredible impact on James, because 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 7 tells us that Jesus made a personal appearance to James. And that appearance must have been the thing that removed any remaining doubts and reservations about Jesus' claim to be the Messiah, the Son of God. And what's so amazing about this transformation was that James was immediately included among the believers in Jerusalem in the opening pages of the book of Acts. Now keep in mind that what we read in the beginning of the book of Acts is only a little over a month after the resurrection. And it wasn't too long after that James became a leading figure in the Lord's church. And we know that again because when Peter was released from prison in Acts chapter 12 by an angel and ended up rejoining the brethren at the home of Mary, the mother of John Mark, Peter told them the details of this miraculous deliverance and said, by the way, don't forget to tell James and the brethren about this. Later, when the apostles and elders met to discuss the question of whether or not the Gentiles should be admitted to the church and what kind of, you know, stipulations there might be, it was James who made the final and definitive statement in Acts chapter 15. And even the apostle Paul reported what happened on his third missionary journey to James in Acts chapter 21. In fact, James had become so influential in the Lord's church that he is called one of the pillars of the church at Jerusalem there in Galatians chapter 2 and verse 9. And so James, the brother of Jesus, is the James that works as our author of the letter of James. And he was, in fact, you know, a James that really worked. He worked hard, right? He worked on his faith, and his faith worked him, and his faith was shown by his works. Now, think about this. James had become so well known that extra-biblical writers not, you know, who wrote the Bible, had plenty to say about him. As a matter of fact, secular history tells us that James was known as the just, because being just was one of his many virtues. And the early Christian historian Eusebius says that James spent so much time on his knees in prayer that they had grown worn and hard like those of a camel, so much so that James earned the nickname Old Camel Knees. Okay. So now, you know, let's think about James a little bit. Let's think of James not as old camel knees, but as the brother of Jesus. He's, you know, after all, the second oldest in the family. And so as the second oldest brother, you know, it's bad enough when you're the second oldest and your brother always does everything right, you do everything wrong. Jesus never did anything wrong, right? You know, and you kind of have to think about that. He grew up in the same house with Jesus. So if anything ever happened, who broke that dish? Well, it wasn't Jesus. It must have been James, you know. So it was always James. It was always James's fault. Anyway, he grew up in the same house with Jesus, and he witnessed firsthand the sinless life of Jesus. Who took the bread? Which one of you boys took the bread? It wasn't Jesus. Hey, it must have been James, right? So Jesus never sinned. We're sure of that from scriptures. So talk about having the best child in the house, right? He's the number one. So James had to live with all that, but still, James also learned a lot, right? James did hear the teachings of Jesus. And we know that Jesus had knowledge of the scriptures at a very young age because he's in the temple at the age 12, and the teachers of the law are amazed at his teaching. So James is growing up with his older brother Jesus. He's hearing all this teaching and Jesus' ways, and he's learning from that. But still, even after all that exposure to the Messiah, living with him, James was an unbeliever and a stumbling block to Jesus until he had witnessed the resurrected Lord. Okay, back to James chapter 1 and verse 1. Knowing that Jesus was his brother, James could have pulled what I'm calling the Jesus card out. You know, he could have said, hey, I'm James, the brother of Jesus. You know me, right? He's my brother. But he didn't do that, right? Instead, he calls himself a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's because James knows it's more important for Jesus to be his Lord than for him to be his physical brother. Think about it. To James, the most important thing in his life was that he was a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. And really, that's an incredible display of humility on James's part. He saw himself as a simple servant of God and just wanted to make sure that others saw him that way too, because that's who he really was. That's who he genuinely was. And when we stop to think about it, you know, that's a really good example for you and me, isn't it? You know, to not lord it over others, but to instead serve others in love, leading them in both our example and doctrine. And that's exactly what Jesus did, right? I mean, over in Matthew chapter 20 and verses 26 and 28, Jesus taught whoever wants to be the greatest must be a servant. And as his example, he said, just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give himself a ransom. And so Jesus taught and was the example. And so James learned that, and he taught and was the example. And so we need to learn that too and teach and be the example. And our faith and our works need to match up, you see. So, who is the author of this letter again? Well, the answer is James, the brother of Jesus. He is the James that fits the best or works. Okay, now the second question that we want to answer this morning is, to whom is this letter written? And we'll answer that with the people that work. So which people work or fit the profile from the context of this letter? Well, again, keep in mind that all of the letters in the New Testament were written to specific people with specific purposes in mind. What I mean by that is, you know, James just didn't sit down and think, well, I'm going to write a 5-chapter book of the Bible and chapter 1, verse... They didn't do that, okay? James sat down and wrote a personal letter to people that he had a sense of personal responsibility to. And so James encouraged them in very much the same way a loving father would encourage his children with both authority and love. Okay, so just who were the people that James wrote this letter to? Well, again, the very first verse tells us that it was written to the 12 tribes scattered among the nations. Now, some people try to Christianize that verse and say that, well, James was writing to Gentile Christians who were scattered after the persecution of the church there in Acts chapter 8. But that doesn't take into account the specific wording identifying the 12 tribes. To a Gentile, that wouldn't mean a whole lot of anything. But the 12 tribes would mean a lot to a Jew. And so the 12 tribes referenced in James 1:1 is clearly talking about the 12 tribes of Israel, the people of Israel. In other words, those Jews who put Christ on a baptism. But again, like all of the Christians who were forced to flee Jerusalem during the persecution, they were also scattered about, you know, and now they were all out living among the nations. In other words, among people who weren't Jews, who weren't Hebrews, you know. In other words, Gentiles. Okay, so how are they the people that work? Well, again, remember that James was a leader in the church in Jerusalem, and he probably helped to teach and to counsel and to guide many of these Jews who had lived in Jerusalem and helped them to become Christians, and then afterwards helped them to learn about how to live like Christ and how to deal with things like we're reading in James, the book, right, the letter, about how to deal with trials and temptations and things like that. Plus, the overall context of the book of James really lends to people being Jewish Christians. Because, you know, think about it, James uses men like Abraham and Elijah and Job to illustrate his messages to make them easier to understand. And Gentiles, they go, yeah, okay, Abraham, well, who are those guys, you know? So if James was writing to Gentile Christians, the use of Abraham, Elijah, and Job just wouldn't make a whole lot of sense. And so James is writing to Jews who had become Christians, who had been scattered among non-Jewish areas. And of course, as we can imagine, their general life and spiritual life must have been quite a challenge. As a matter of fact, we don't have to imagine that because right there in James chapter 1 and verse 2, we're told that, you know, they were going through many trials of many different kinds, you know. And so James wanted to help them by writing a letter that would circulate among them and strengthen their faith and increase their courage and warn them against spiritual indifference. You know, we can just kind of picture how excited that they would be, you know, to receive a letter from their beloved brother and spiritual leader, James, you know. You know, and as we look deeper into the letter of James over the next several weeks, you know, like the people that work, or those, again, James wrote to, we're going to find some very practical and challenging words from James. Because, again, James is one of the most down-to-earth and sensible books of the Bible. James tells us how to conform our attitudes and our speech and our behavior to the will of God so that we can be the light of the world and the salt of the earth. It's a letter that shows us how Christianity is a faith that works and how faith and works go together. And that's something we always need to remember. You know, that faith and works do go together. That reminds me of a story about an old farmer who decided to buy his very first chainsaw. Well, the farmer was visited by a logger who was selling equipment, you know. And so the logger sold him a chainsaw, promising him that it would cut down 15 trees a day. Well, about a week later, a very unhappy farmer got in touch with the logger and told him that the chainsaw just had to be faulty, that it just didn't work. He complained that it only averaged 3 trees a day. Well, you know, the logger didn't want to be called a liar, and so he went on over to a tree, grabbed the chainsaw, pulled the cord, and the saw started up and went, and whoa, the farmer stopped him and said, hey, what's that sound? See, the farmer never started it up. He just took the chainsaw and scraped it up against the tree. He had a chainsaw, but he wasn't working it. We got to make sure that our faith and works go together, right, in order to get things done. And you can have a faith that works too. But first, you have to have faith and then act upon that faith. So if you're not yet a Christian, you just need to have faith, right? That Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. And then upon your trust in him, act on your faith and turn to him in repentance, confessing him as Lord and Savior, and then commit yourself to him by being immersed in the watery grave for the forgiveness of your sins. And then rising up out of the water, you continue to live your life for him until Jesus comes back again or you go to be with him. And for those of us who already understand that faith and works go together, might we do our best to help those who don't understand to have a faith that works? And so, if anyone has the need to share, seek prayer, or to become a Christian for the very first time, I would like to encourage you to message us through YouTube or Facebook, or you could email me directly at minister@obchurch.org. Let's pray. Father God, we want to thank you again for being our God and Father, for giving us your word. We want to thank you for letters like the one we have in the New Testament, the book of James, and all the very practical, down-to-earth messages that we find in the book. And Father, as we study that book over the next couple of weeks, help us, Father, to have a faith that works. Father, we thank you for loving us and for giving us your word so that we could grow to be closer like your Son. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Again, we want to thank you for making us a part of your Lord's Day and pray that you'll worship with us again the next time we meet here in Orangevale, Sunday mornings at 9 a.m. at our building. Of course, we understand that that might not be possible for some people, and so we hope that you'll continue to assemble with us online Sunday mornings at 11 here on Facebook and YouTube. Thank you, and God bless.